This audiobook is distributed by Christian Audio. Please visit christianaudio.com to offer your impressions of this work and to explore additional titles.
Welcome to the Ministry of Living on the Edge with Chip Ingram. We trust that the upcoming message will inspire, encourage, and motivate you to apply what you learn as you live out your faith in Christ at home and at work each day. At the end of the message, you'll find information on how to contact Living on the Edge or obtain additional resources. Now, here's Chip.
You are a relational being. You are created by God first and foremost to have your heart and your soul connected to Him. And then the second and most powerful way He wants to express His love to you is He wants to bring another person into your life, and He wants your hearts to connect and your minds to connect and your emotions to connect. And yes, even at the right time and the right way, expressing all that, your body to connect. He wants you to give love and receive love. He wants you to understand what sex is, where it should be, and how it can be better and deeper and richer than you can ever imagine. And then He wants to give you the ability to go through life with someone that when you are down and when you are hurting and when you're not a good person to live with, someone looks in your eyes and they see the ugliness and they see the lack of patience and they see the carnality and they smile and they love you anyway. You're looking for that person. I found that person. Some of you are in a relationship, but that doesn't describe it. Some of you are waiting for that relationship to happen. And some of you are in a thing called marriage right now, and you're saying, you know something? I've heard that it's supposed to be like that. But buddy, I got news for you. Mine isn't working that way. It's the longing of every single person's heart. I mean, imagine, what music? I mean, every single song on the radio. What is almost every song about? Every movie, unless they're blowing someone up, or it's science fiction, or body parts are flying around, what's the movie about? It's about romance. What's the top-selling fiction? Romance novels. I mean, every MTV or VH1 clip, I mean, if they're not blowing someone up or having drive-by shootings, what's it about? I mean, someone is dancing and the glance here and they meet someone there, right? And all of us are living this life to have that deep connection. We want to be loved. We want to enjoy God-ordained, God-given, beautiful act of sex, and we want it to last. But the fact of the matter is, for all of our desire, for all the books, all the movies, and all the songs, and this isn't a new thing. I mean, you can go back 2,000 years and read Greek literature. You can go back to Egyptian literature. Human beings are human beings, and we want to be loved, and sex is important, and we want it to last. Tonight, I want to talk to you about two models. There's two prescriptions out there, two ways that people are saying, you can have this, you can get this. One works and the other doesn't. You're going to find a little teaching handout. Why don't you pull that out? And if you have a pen, I'm going to put you to work, so pull that out as well. I want to look at first model number one that I call Hollywood's prescription for lasting relationships. And by that, I don't mean that Hollywood actually made it up, but it comes out of Hollywood. It comes out of the movies. It comes out of the songs. It comes out of VH1, MTV. It comes out of the self-help literature. And if you will, it's almost a four-step formula. I mean, I wish I had a little black box and I could take every movie that you've ever seen, old, new, ever since you were a little kid, every song that has ever gone into your brain, every book that you've ever read, any video that you've ever rented, take all the content and go, and put it inside this box. And then we could hook it up and push a few buttons, and then out of all those movies, all those books, all those videos would come out, if you want to have love, sex, and a lasting relationship, literally, here would be the formula. Number one, find the right person. You got to find the right person. I mean, isn't that the key? He's out there. She's out there. You got to find him. That means you got to get out there on the hunt. And if you're going to get out there on the hunt, you got to be good bait, right? You got to wear the right kind of jeans. You got to have the right kind of shoes. You got to have the sweater that's in. You got to pump a little iron and drink a little creatine, right? Because you got to look good. Because we're on the hunt and we're looking and we want to find that person. And on every commercial and billboard and magazine, even when we walk out of the checkout stand, Cosmo and 17 and Star and Inquirer and People tell us what looks good, what looks cool, and if you want to find the J-Lo or the Julia of your dreams, the Cameron or the Brad Pitt of your dreams, then you got to look a certain way, but go find them. And we have an entire world doing what? Looking, looking, looking. Step number two, if you watch the movies, and it happens in all the movies, right, is find the right person and then fall in love. You don't know how it'll happen. It's magical. It's mystical, right? You know, you might just be taking tickets at the subway, and he walks by. Your eyes meet. And you're in love. Or you might be walking into a Starbucks. You bump into her. You look. She looks. Your eyes meet. There's chemistry. There's something about, and you tell your friend, I've met him. I've met him. What? Where? What? What's his name? I don't know. Well, where does he go to school? I don't know. Well, how old is he? I don't know, but I met him and I'm in love. Just the chemistry, it starts. In fact, it might be out in the old days, we used to call it cruising. Friday night, get those windows down. You keep going around and around the old Sonic. Wear the t-shirts that are all the way cut out if you're a guy. And maybe you'll meet. And we believe that someday, some way, if we look the right way, they're out there for us, and we're going to put on the right kind of makeup and the right kind of jewelry and the right kind of jeans and the right kind of sweaters. And when the labels change, we're going to go shop at just the right places, and especially the places where the guys have their shirts off in the middle of when you walk in, because it tells you if you wear this stuff, you're going to look like him. And then this magical moment will happen. You will feel ooey-gooey all over. You'll start to melt. You'll have a tingly feeling that starts at the top of your head. It'll go all the way to your toes. And in movie after movie after movie and video and book, we watch it happen in multiple ways. What? And they fall in love. And then after they fall in love, what? You can tell me the next one, right? Step one, find the right person. Step two, fall in love. Step three, what do? We set or fix our hopes and dreams on this person. I'll never forget my college roommate. The first experience I saw of this, 6'6", we played basketball together. He literally walked in, tall, thin guy. He walked in like this. Whoa, whoa, whoa. I said, Phil, what's going on? He says, I am in love. I said, really? He said, yeah, I am in love. What's her name? I don't know yet, but I am in love. And he began to talk about it. And I mean, every day then, he would, you know, tell me, you know, do I look okay? And do you think these jeans look good with this? And then he got to know her name. And then they started going out. And then Phil disappeared. I mean, he barely showed up to practice. He didn't do his homework. He didn't go to class. Why? He fixed his hopes, his dreams. Everything that mattered was her. She was going to fulfill him. When you really fall in love, head over heels, your IQ drops about 30 points. You do things that people tell you that's stupid. You spend money you don't have. You stay up late. You get up early. You do nutty, crazy, bizarre things because you're in love. And this person's going to come through. This is what you've always wanted. And the feelings are so powerful. You look into her eyes, and she looks into yours. Oh, right? Step four, however, is that if failure occurs, repeat steps one, two, and three. You see, how many of us have had this experience? Not once, not twice, not three times, not four times, not five times. How many of us have gone through the cycle and, quote, found the right person, fallen in love, fixed our hopes and dreams on them, you get to know them a little bit, and then you find out they do something really rotten, like go out with someone else? Or you get really close to them and you find they have a violent temper and they blow up. Or you find that, boy, you know what, she is really, really good looking, but boy, she's selfish. Or you know what, he has been pumping a lot of iron, but all he does is pump iron and look in the mirror at himself. He's a jerk. And so what you find out when it doesn't work, what do? You repeat the cycle. Step one, go back to find the right person, fall in love. And you know what, I have you ever watched Entertainment Tonight? You know, where they kind of tell you who the stars are, or people when you walk out the checkout stand, who's hot, what the couples are, and is it Ben and J-Lo, or maybe J-Lo, or just Ben, or Ben and J-Lo, or on, off. I mean, let's not even talk about Britney. And you know, we kind of laugh at that, but isn't there something weirdly curious about how interested we are? And I don't know about you, but when I step back 3 or 4 steps, I think how sad. The people that are the most beautiful, the people that have the most wealth, the people that, quote, could find and have anyone, quote, they would want, seem to be totally unable to keep a relationship that lasts more than a year or two, and often only a matter of months. And they change partners like people change underwear. And when they're interviewed, oh, he's the best. I've never had anything like this in my life. 3 months later, he's the best. I've never had anything like this in my life. 4 months later. And what you find is, it's what you hear, it's what you sing, it's what you watch, it's the videos that we rent, it's the books that we read. And I want to tell you, Christian or not, believer or unbeliever, it's in the air, it's in the water, it's now in your genes, it is in your mind, and whether you know it or not, you have at some level bought into Hollywood's prescription. You believe, consciously or unconsciously, if I'm ever going to have great love, real sex, and a relationship that lasts, I got to find the right person. And then somehow, some way, I don't know how, I'm going to fall in love. And then I'm going to fix my hope and dreams on them, and they'll be the right one. And then when it's not, here's the assumption. Oh, it was just for a season. Or it wasn't really the right one. Or we've drifted apart. Remember that? I guess they're not the right one for me anymore because it's not working. It's frustrating. It's hard. I don't feel fulfilled. I don't feel love. She's not coming through for me. So what do? We go back out and fish and go through the whole cycle. As you look at your notes, notice the success rate. The divorce rate, the population of divorced people in 1970 was about 4.3 million people. In 1996, 26 years later, the divorce rate was 18.3 million people. Since the silver screen and the revolution of the 60s and the free love and we can now have it all, the most rapidly growing population in all of America is those that are divorced. Those who cohabitate have quadrupled because a lot of people realize this doesn't work and it's painful going through all the legal stuff. We'll just live together and then we break apart. And the pain and the fallout and the damage, you know what? Many groups I have to really talk about this, but probably not with this group. Can I ask a question, not embarrassing anyone? How many of either you, your parents, or one of your closest friends has been divorced? Could you just raise your hand? Look around. What is that, 80? Maybe 80% of this room? And you know what? It's not like on TV is. It's not like, well, they broke up and, you know, they're still kind and we're still friends. They always say like that on TV, that, oh, we're still friends and we see one another and, you know, the magazine articles, they just, that's not how it really works, is it? There's pain. There's devastation. A third of all the women who are divorced find themselves living below the poverty level at some time in their life. The economic ramifications, what happens to the children, what happens to friends, what happens to in-laws. This is destructive. This is painful. We've been deceived. We've been hoodwinked. It doesn't work. In fact, it's well beyond even just the shallow, oh, it didn't work and it's painful, but you'll get over it. Isn't that what we tell them? You know, the kids are resilient. They'll bounce back. U.S. News, weekly magazine, Children of a Divorce, landmark study 25 years later. It says this landmark study tracked kids from broken homes for a quarter of a century. 25 years. They tracked kids from broken homes to see the impact of divorce, that it continues well into adulthood. It starts off, a part of me is always waiting for disaster to strike. I live in dread that some terrible loss will change my life. That, according to psychoanalyst Judith Wallerson, is what divorce sounds like 25 years after the fact among those it hits the hardest, children. You notice how quiet it is in here? Some people's minds are playing little videotapes and memories of the pain that you have in your life. There are no easy divorces. There are no, well, we're just friends and the kids will be okay. The pain and the damage and the fallout and the chaos goes on and on and on. In fact, The article goes on to say, in the short term, divorce is always troublesome for children, says Mavis Hetherington. She's the divorce researcher and now professor emeritus of psychology at the University of Virginia. She's videotaped and scrutinized, listen to this, the workings of 1,400 divorced families since the early 70s. Hetherington pinpoints a crisis period of about 2 years in the immediate aftermath of separation when the adults are preoccupied with their own lives and they typically take their eye off parenting just at the time when the children are reeling from the loss like never before. 25 years later, pain, damage. A lady came to me in a restaurant. I went back to Santa Cruz to see, I have three grown sons, and two are married and one's engaged, and they were all back there. All their wives are out of Santa Cruz, and we went to see them and went to a little restaurant on Saturday night. And as I went to the restaurant, someone said, "Chip, Chip," and this lady that I didn't recognize came out, and she literally came out and she grabbed both hands. It was a little bit embarrassing, like, "Lady, I don't know what you're doing, and I don't know you from Adam." And she just said, "Thank you. Thank you. I want to thank you. I want to thank you." And now I'm thinking, my wife's going to walk around the corner in just a second. I got some lady I don't know holding my hands telling me thank you in a weird voice. And I said, "For what?" She said, "I came to divorce recovery at Santa Cruz Bible Church. I've been through a litany of relationships and multiple marriages. And I remember you put a picture of a triangle on the board at divorce recovery. And you pictured for me how I believed relationships should be done and how most of us do them. Hollywood's formula, you called it. And then you showed me a different way." And she said, "After all the pain and all the fallout and everything I've been through, you see that table over there? I came there. That was 2 years ago. That's my husband. I want you to know that God put my life back together. I want you to know that I canned Hollywood's formula. It doesn't work, and I did it God's way. And there is pain, and there's stuff to put back together. But I want to tell you that real love is possible, and I didn't think it was ever possible for someone like me." And then she just started the, "Thank you, thank you." I said, "Ma'am, you got to understand, it's God's truth. It's the power of the Lord Jesus that did it. I'm just the messenger." She goes, "I know, I know." And so, you know, I kind of got over and ate my meal. And before we left, this lady comes over to our table, and she just stood where none of us could get out. And she said, "Thank you all. Thank you." Then she looked at my wife, "Thank you. Thank you." And I'm here to tell you, Hollywood's formula will bring disaster to your relationships. And I'm not asking, do you buy into it? It's just, how much have you already bought into it? And I don't know that we'll ever escape it in the culture that we're in. But I want to tell you that there is something that you're being told day in and day out, on commercials, on TV, in books, in music. You sing the words, "I can't live without you, baby," right? Boy, that's an old one. And I want to tell you there's another model, and it works. And that God has a plan for authentic love, dynamic sex, and a relationship that'll last. Turn the page with me, if you will, and let's look at model number two. This is God's prescription for a lasting relationship. If you have your Bible, will you please open it to Ephesians chapter 4? God's prescription for a lasting relationship is best summed up with just two verses. In contrast to the fall in love after finding the right person, fixing your hopes and dreams on them, and then starting over if it doesn't work, God would say, in summarizing relationships and how they work, "Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering, a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma." And I ask you to open your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 4, because did you notice the very first word? I said I'd put you to work. It says therefore. Circle the word therefore, because we know it comes from something else. And what I want you to know is that you are the object of the most loving, generous being in all the universe, and it is God. And he sent his son Jesus, fully God, fully man, on this earth to walk and to live and to heal and to teach and to raise the dead and to love the poor and to display truth and grace so that you would know that God loves you. And at a certain point in time, if you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, a miraculous thing happens. Just as a person is physically born, the Scripture says there is a second birth, a spiritual birth. And just as a physical birth brings life into existence, a spiritual birth brings spiritual life into existence. And the first three chapters of Ephesians talk about what actually happened when a person understands they've violated a holy God, and when you turn from your sin and repent and say, Lord Jesus, forgive me. It says the Spirit of God comes into your life. Your past is put behind you. You are redeemed. You're reconciled. You are forgiven. The Spirit seals you for God's own use. You have an inheritance. You're filled with His Spirit. You are loved unconditionally. You're taken out of the kingdom of darkness and placed into the kingdom of light. You have new power. You have new life. And the first three chapters of Ephesians say, this is what happens when you move from the kingdom of darkness into fellowship with God through Jesus Christ. A new identity. You are secure. You are loved. You are precious. You are valuable. You're the object of God's thoughts. He thinks of you. Jesus prays for you night and day. You become a part of His family with all the privileges. And then chapter 4 opens up and says, well, walk in a manner worthy of your calling. Literally, the word has the idea of an axis. You've been given all this. Now live it out in such a way that your speech and your thoughts and your relationships and your heart and your money and your time and your agenda and your dreams, they reflect this new person that you are. And as you see it, he says we're to walk in light, we're to walk in love, and we're to walk in truth, or walk in holiness. And in verses 25 to 32 of Ephesians chapter 4, he says, those of you who used to steal, stop stealing and begin to be generous and to give. Those of you who lie, stop lying and speak the truth in love. Those of you that used your tongue to put down and manipulate and hurt people, don't do no unwholesome word out of your mouth, but only words that give grace and life and love. And then by the time he gets toward the end, he says, those of you who had a series of attitudes of bitterness and anger and malice that grew out of your own self-centeredness, put away all those destructive relational attitudes, and then look in the Bible. Look at verse 32. What's it say? But be, literally, it's show yourself kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another. How? Just as God in Christ also forgave you. And then our verse, therefore, what's it say? Be imitators of God. How? As dearly loved children, and walk in love. And then it describes how. See, the therefore tells you exactly how to do relationships. We're to do it the same way God does relationships. You still have that pen out. If you will, underline the word be imitators and underline the little phrase walk in love. There's two commands in this passage. The first command is that we're to be imitators of God. Have you ever heard the word mimic, to mimic someone? You know, they do something and you mimic them. That's this Greek word. You're literally to mimic God. And in the grammar, the word be is up front. It's a command. Demonstrate or be a mimic of God. And how do you do that? As a dearly loved child, you do it out of the resources of what He's already done in your life. The second command is then to walk in love. And here the idea is it's not an experience, it's a choice. It's a habitual lifestyle of walking in love. Well, what's it look like to walk in love? Look at the phrase, just as Christ also loved you. How did He love you? One, He gave Himself up for us. Why did He do it? An offering and a sacrifice to God. The offering looks at His devotion, the sacrifice looks at the price. And then notice this last phrase, as a fragrant aroma. That word is only used in the Old Testament as a free will offering. We could spend a lot of time exegeting those two verses, but let me instead do this. I want to give you God's prescription in the same kind of four steps that parallel Hollywood's. And then we're going to talk about how to put these into practice and how literally this is a way where you can experience authentic love, the kind of sex God intended, and a relationship that lasts. And so, step number one would become the right person. Instead of find the right person, it's become the right person. Can you imagine the shift in orientation? And you're saying, what do you mean, become the right person? I mean, mimic God. Become the kind of person that mimics God. Well, what is God like? Well, look at verse 32 of chapter 4. Mimic his kindness. Mimic his generosity. Mimic his tender-heartedness. Treat people with a tender heart. Forgive people the way God forgives people. And by the way, who is God kind to? Is he just kind to the people that he likes? It says he causes the rain to fall on the wicked and on the righteous. He says that who are we to love? We're to love others even as he loves us. And so God says, if you want to have the kind of relationships, instead of focusing on getting out on the hunt, kind of looking in the mirror to find out what those jeans really fit right, he says, why don't you start and look at your heart instead? Instead of focusing outward and saying, I'm going to find her, I'll find him, I'll find her, I'll find him, why don't you start with you, and you become the kind of person that mimics God. You become the kind of person that is winsome and generous, the kind of person that we all like to be around, that's kind, it's caring, the kind of person that isn't self-focused but outwardly focused, the kind of person that when you're wounded, instead of taking your ball and go home and blaming other people and talking about them behind their back, yes, you're wounded, you look at it, and you forgive them in the same way that God forgave you. You make it your goal to become the right kind of person. Become a man or a woman of God. Become the kind of person, are you ready for this, that you'd really like to marry. I mean, what are you really looking for? I mean, as one guy told me after 20 or 30 years, all the things that attracted you externally, those body parts start to shift around a little bit. I mean, with all the cosmetic surgery and all the rest, they keep shifting. And God gave us a sexual dynamic visual attraction for one another, but if you base your relationship on that, it doesn't work. When one of your children is in intensive care, you're not really too worried about your waist size. When you go through a devastating loss and one of your parents die, when you walk out of a doctor's office and they say, by the way, before you go, we ran that biopsy. It's positive. Now, you know, we have treatment, but you got about 20% chance to live. Do you want to look across to the person who walked out of that doctor's office with you and know they are loyal, they are committed, they are with you, they will stick with you the way God sticks with you? Isn't that what you want? You know what kind of person those people attract? Those kind of people are looking for that same kind of person. And so if you really want the kind of relationships that will satisfy deeply, don't focus on finding the right person. Focus on becoming the right person. Second, walk in love. Walk in love, he says, what that looks like. It means you're a giver instead of a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.